Okay. thank you. Good afternoon. I would like to start by thanking very much the organizer to bring us in this lovely place and give me the opportunity to talk about the work we are doing in UPMC, in Laboratoire d'Imagerie Biomédicale. So there will be, I think, almost no equations. It's mostly about experimental results, which is a documentation of properties of bone, and the focus is on the elastic properties, and the focus is also on cortical bone, as opposed to the work on trabecular bone that we've seen before. So cortical bone is a dense tissue. The porosity, the pore volume fraction, is limited to say 20%. So the mechanical properties of this material are a lot due to the intrinsic mechanical properties of the mineralized collagen matrix, and also of course to the pore volume fraction and to the organization of this pore network to a limited extent, as we will see. So cortical bone is concentrated in the diaphyses of the bones with different thickness depending on where you are. The empty space here is marrow. If you have a very young, healthy subject, if you are at this level, you can find some trabecula inside, but for older subjects, there is almost nothing. And anyway, if you're in the middle, it's marrow.
Okay. 20% is...
So this is this... okay. Cortical bone is this one, and the black part is vessels and nerves and some soft tissues like that, mostly vessels. Okay, the marrow is in the medullar space. So we are working with the mesoscale, which is a scale of a few centimeters, of a few, sorry, a few millimeters. And there is an issue, an experimental issue and a modeling issue in cortical bone, that is the thickness of the bone is always, is very often limited to a few millimeters. And furthermore, you can see a strong gradient of porosity in the back cases, in particular in older people. So there is a problem of the definition of the representative volume element, and there is a problem of separation of scale. So in the homogenization works that have been done in cortical bone, most of the time scale separation is assumed. And if the porosity is limited to 20%, you can assume that with a representative volume element of 2 millimeters, it can be satisfactory to calculate significant mechanical properties. It also means that if you want to do a mechanical testing on a cortical bone sample, you need a quite small sample, because even if you have a very thick cortical thickness, the porosity is changing. So if you want really to test a material, you need to have some representative volume with a homogeneous distribution of the pores, so that the samples will generally be only a few millimeters. So we are interested in elasticity, and we are measuring the stiffness tensor of the bone. We limit the analysis to orthotropy framework. That means that we are interested in, at the most, 9 elastic coefficients of the bone, and we are going to measure this coefficient and look at their variations. So why do we investigate bone, cortical bone elasticity? First reason is also in the context of this workshop to understand growth and adaptation mechanism, because if you know the forces that applies on the bone, if you want to calculate the strain at the cell level, you need to know the elasticity of the tissue. So that's an important fact. Of course, if you want to apply mechanical laws to orthopedics problem or to estimate fracture risk, then you need to build some realistic model in which you need to input some realistic elastic properties. And the last point is very important for us in our lab. Elasticity vivo with ultrasound methods, and this is a part of what we do in the lab to design such ultrasound methods to measure in vivo the quality of the bone. So these are examples of the devices that we've been working in, working with. This measures the heel bone at the so this is mostly trabecular bone, but here there is a measurement at the radius. We measure wave propagating in the cortex, and we can deduce the elasticity of the bone in vivo. And measurement can also be done to some extent at the femur. So our research question that I will address in this talk are: what are the values and the range of variations of the elastic properties in different bone sites, in different bones? What are the determinants of elasticity variations? We want to determine some statistical relationships between porosity, mineral, elasticity, and also we want to find some models to account for this variation. And finally, related to the fact that we can, with ultrasound method, measure in vivo elasticity, we want to know if stiffness, elasticity, can be a marker of the biomechanical competence. That is, if the elasticity is less in a patient, does this mean that this patient is more prone to fracture than another one? To what extent is elasticity representative of the strength or the resistance to fracture properties of a bone? I think this is an interesting question for a mechanician. So, first thing, how do we measure the stiffness of the bone? We've been working with a method which is called the resonant ultrasound spectroscopy that exists since the 1990s, and we've developed it further in the lab to adapt the method to measure bone. And the idea is to take a bone sample like this. So this is a parallelepiped, rectangular parallelepiped sample of dimensions of typically 2, 3, 4 millimeters, and we put this sample between two ultrasonic transducers, and we measure the mechanical resonances of these samples. Putting the sample like this, the sample is freely vibrating, so we can think of a model of a vibrating sample with free boundary conditions. And this is an illustration of the method. We measure the resonant frequencies of the sample, which are the experimental resonant frequencies, and then we have a forward model which predicts the frequencies for test values of the stiffness tensor, and then we solve the optimization problem with a straightforward objective function which minimizes the distance between experimental and modeled frequencies. You mean in terms of anisotropy?
Yes.
In principle, any anisotropy can be handled. This has been done by some authors. In bone, it's not possible, for the reason that I'm showing now, that this is cheating, because this spectrum is for metallic samples, it's for copper. For bone, it doesn't look like this. It looks more like this. So you can hardly see the resonances, because bone is somewhat viscoelastic, so the widths of the resonance are large and they overlap. So that was the issues to measure bone with this method, was to find a way to pick the peaks that you cannot see. So there is some signal processing there. So it's not really the topic of the workshop, so I will go faster here, but we have this method, RUS, which is a method that is well adapted to measure small anisotropic samples. The method was basically designed for this purpose. So this is a specimen of dentin, of human dentin, that we have measured. The precision is typically a few percent, and one interesting characteristic in RUS is that it's more precise to measure shear stiffness than longitudinal stiffness, as opposed to some other mechanical testing. And because we measure the entire stiffness tensor of the bone, we can recover also Young modulus, portion ratio, which are used by most of the authors in bone biomechanics. So what about the elasticity variations and their determinants? We have been working in the last 4 or 5 years in the framework of 2 projects that were funded by the French ANR funding agency. First project is Multips, which will end in about 6 months. It involves several labs in Grenoble and in Lyon, associated with Synchrotron, with ESRF in particular. And in this project, there was it's only experimental project with different modalities to measure bone at different scales. So we took pieces of bone in the middle of the diaphysis, and we cut the bone in many adjacent pieces, and they were measured with ultrasound to get the elasticity. There was some toughness test and some measurement at the lacunar canaliculi scale, some measurement of the quality of the mineral, of the quality of the collagen. So this is a database that we are now putting up, and that we are analyzing the relationships between the different properties, and in particular we are trying to explain the variation of stiffness. And another project was the project Tacosan, which was co-funded by the DFG, which is the German funding agency. This is a collaboration with 2 German laboratories. And in this project, it's on femur and tibia. So one of the questions was, if we measure with ultrasound at the tibia, the elastic properties of the bone, because the tibia is very accessible. You can feel your tibia here, so you can put an ultrasound probe, you can measure something. But this is not a fracture site. The fracture site is more there. So we want to know if the bone properties at the tibia are representative of the bone properties at the femur. And so this is the leitmotiv of the project. And also different methods were used to quantify the different properties of the bones, and in particular the RUS technique. So overall, we have in the lab the data for all these bones, for the radius, the femur neck, upper shaft and mid diaphysis of the femur, and the tibia for several subjects. There are more than 200 samples in total that have been measured with the same technique. And we now are compiling this data to obtain some trends. So first, the first way to look at the data is to look at the relationship between elastic properties and the density. So this is an example for coefficient C11, which is one of the compression coefficient of the bone, and C44, which is one of the shear coefficients. So the data looks the same for the different coefficients. This is just an example. For the different bones, so maybe you can hardly see, but the red is for the different sites at the femur, and the blue is for tibia, and black is for radius. The first thing that we see is that if we look at the entire range of density of the cortical bone sample, there is a variation of more than 100% of the elastic properties in the range. So you cannot think of cortical bone as being a material with a constant elasticity. We see here, interestingly, for the tibia, lower elasticity for the same density, and for the radius, a higher elasticity. And we cannot explain this at the moment. We also looked at anisotropy ratios. People who are modeling elastic properties of bone have been looking a lot at anisotropy ratios, because it's an indicator whether the model works well or not. So the variation of anisotropy ratio is moderate, about 20%, and they can be different in the different bones. And the range of variation and the values of the anisotropy ratio that we find here, about 1.5, between 1.5 and 2, are very much consistent with the models that are available in the literature. If you consider, we have some models here, for instance, if you consider an idealized bone, which is just a homogeneous matrix, which is transversely isotropic, and which has pores very regular on a lattice, on an hexagonal lattice like here, you can predict this variation of anisotropy ratio, which is consistent with experimental data. Unfortunately, this is as a function of density, and this is as a function of porosity, so you cannot compare directly, but the range of the values is similar. Now, density is a combination of porosity and also the mineral content. So it's better to look at the data in terms of porosity and mineral content separately. So this is the variation observed between one elastic coefficient and the porosity. And we have this trend for all the coefficients, that is, the variation of porosity explains a very large part of the variation of the stiffness. So we see that for consistently for all the coefficients. And what we found very recently is the relationship between the elastic coefficient here for C11, here for C44, and the DMB, which is the content of the mineral in the bone matrix. And in fact, you expect that when the bone is more mineralized, it will be stiffer. But at least for human bone samples, many authors have failed to show this. Also, you expect it. Why? Because the interval of variation of mineral content is very small. The variation is +5%, -5%, starting from a nominal value. So you need to measure very precisely the mineral content in particular. And if you try to do this with a desktop microscanner, in general, you cannot do it because it's not enough precise. And here we could show the relationship, I think, because we resorted to synchrotron radiation, synchrotron microcity, which is intrinsically much more precise than desktop CT, and allows to show this, to observe this relationship. So we see overall a 20% increase of elasticity for a 10% increase in mineral content. And so this data can be used to test some models. Some models are already existing. And so what we need now to do is to use this data to test critically the model that try to predict the elasticity at the mesoscale. So as I said, if you know the porosity of a bone sample, you already know a lot about its elasticity. You just know one number, the porosity, and you can predict more or less the entire stiffness tensor. So this is true to some extent. You can ask yourself, for instance, at one value of porosity, I see all these points. So there is some scatter, which is due to the experimental errors, of course, but which is not only due to experimental errors. So there is a scatter, and you can ask yourself why this. It can be because the sample have different mineral content, but it can also be because here the relationship is between a scalar porosity and the elastic coefficient. And the porosity is not a scalar because you can hardly see it here. Maybe you see better on the screen. The porosity is a network which has a sophisticated shape. Some pores are connected, some others are not. The length of the pores is more or less long. So we did a simple test to look at the effect of the shape of the pore network on the elasticity. So what we did, we had this micro CT scans at the synchrotron for a series of samples, and we did homogenization. We did numerical homogenization. We used FFT-based homogenization, taking into account the entire structure. So the volume is 3 by 4 by 5 millimeter cube, and we meshed with the FFT method all the pores in the volume at the resolution of the synchrotron to see the effect of the shape of the pores. And in the simulation, the elastic properties of the matrix were the same for all the samples. So the only thing that changes between the different samples is the pore volume fraction and the shape of the pores. And again, we plot, this is the result of the numerical test, one elastic coefficient as a function of pore volume fraction. And you see that almost all the points align on this on this curve, which is just the fit of the points, meaning that if you know the volume fraction, you know quite well the elastic coefficient. You don't need to know the exact shape of the pore network, at least for these samples, which were all taken in the center of the femur. If you look at other sites, if you look at pathological bone, maybe you can have some surprise, but if you look at nominal bone, the pore volume fraction tells you everything. The last part, if we know elasticity, what can we say about say the post-heal behavior, the non-elastic behavior, which is supposed to be more interesting in the context of predicting the fracture or the resistance of a bone. I don't want to disappoint you because there is not much after this slide, so it's more an open topic, something maybe we can discuss in the next days. How can we tackle this problem of the relationship between elasticity and the rest of the mechanical properties? So the data in the literature is typically this one. When we look at the variation of stiffness over a large range, we see consistent variation of strength. So the strength is higher when the stiffness is higher. Maybe because there is more bone, it's more dense, so it's both stiffer and strength. There are different results in the literature indicating this relationship. Here we did one thing. Again, we did some simulations with the macrostructure, but we did nonlinear simulation to predict the yield stress for the samples. So all the samples have the same mechanical properties. The matrix is the same for all the samples, but the shape of the pores is different. So we want to know if we increase the porosity in the sample, do we lower the yield stress, for instance. So numerically, we tested these samples by applying a uniaxial stress, and we plot the result of the numerical experiment is this stress strain curve, and we take one point representative of the end of the linear regime, and this is the yield limit. And this is the porosity. We can see a strong relationship between the yield limit and the porosity. And here we see that for about 30%, we see more than 30% variation in the yield limit for 20% variation in porosity. So it tells you very good cortical bone will have only 5% porosity, and when the bone gets older, you see quite often a 20% porosity. So in this process, you lose about 30% in yield stress or in your bone. This is what the model indicates, and the model has some limitations, of course. And the significance of the results clearly depends on to talk about evolution again, because I went to elementary school also. It also depends on the safety factor on bone design. Okay, you lose 30% of your yield stress, but is this really important? If the safety factor is 10, so maybe you are not in a situation to break the bone. And the last result is one of the relationship between result of the toughness experiment, which is the coefficient K, representative of the energy released with the propagation of a crack, and the Young modulus. And you see the result as is not easy to interpret. There seems to be two population of samples with two different trends of the variation of Young modulus with toughness. So for now, we don't want to conclude on the relationship between toughness and Young's modulus, but we are exploring more this data. So conclusion, resonance transform spectroscopy is now a well-validated technique to measure the entire stiffness tensor of cortical bone samples. The elastic properties of the bones are now rather well documented. We need a validated model of the effect of the variable mineral content because now there is, I think, good data to test such such model. So we should do this. We have not been talking about pathological cases or about the role of collagen. Our data indicate that the role of collagen is not so important for elasticity. I conclude on this. Thank you for your attention.
Could you comment on the effect of moisture condition on the resonant ultrasound? The water content, because you're measuring a very high
the frequency is not so high. It's about one megahertz. Generally. So in general, for mechanical testing of bone, it's very important to control the moisture content. So what we do, the sample are immersed into water, and we just take them out of the water. We do like this to remove any drop of water on the surface, and we measure it. So the assumption is that it's completely hydrated when we measure it. And what we do is that to interpret the resonance experiment, we need mass, because we need mass density. So we measure the sample before the experiment and after the experiment. The interval is a few minutes. So we may see some variation. If we see two important variations, that we will repeat the experiment, and we can control that there is not too much drying during the experiment. So we measure at 1 megahertz, typically. The frequency of measurement depends on the size of the samples. Okay, the smaller the sample, you will have to go to higher frequencies to measure a certain number of resonance. So for our samples, the frequency is about 1 megahertz. Okay, so it seems quite high frequency, but the values of Young modulus that we have are very consistent with the values of Young modulus that others have been measuring with quasi-static measurements. So there is no big bias. That's we are sure. Now we are trying to do our own experiment to measure the Young modulus in the same sample that we measure with Russ to really have a one-to-one comparison between the measurement and the quasi-static measurement. My feeling is that there is no strong bias as I mentioned, and what people do when they're trying to control the dynamic condition on the sample, they control the strain rate. Okay, and in our experiment, the strain rate is not so high because the period is very short, but the displacement during a period is very, very small, much smaller than what we have in the mechanical test. So overall, the strain rate is of the same order of magnitude as the strain rate in a almost quasi-static experiment. You see my point?
Yeah.
I said that if you want to observe a variation of Young modulus based on the time scale of the excitation, you need a larger time scale. we are in a rather small time scale, and bone is, it's well evident that it is viscoelastic in a relaxation experiments. There are many experiments that show that it's viscoelastic and it's attenuating for ultrasound waves. So it's
at, okay. I accept that you have a decent, well established protocol, so measures are reproducible. But I doubt whether, so my question is, how can this, the results obtained from these measures be meaningful as far as the in vivo performance of both is concerned? Since frequency is there, bad.
This is a question, as you can imagine, it's not the first time I'm asked this question, and this is why we are in the process of really measuring for the same samples the elastic properties with the ultrasound technique and with quasi-static mechanical technique. For now, we don't have this data. So all we can say is that the values that we find for a given density of the bone is exactly in the range of what is found by others on other bone samples at the same density. So yeah, it's realistic to say that there is no strong bias. I don't say there is no effect, but...
Thank you. We need to close the session. So.